Well, a warm, pleasant good afternoon from the Cox Convention Center. Dave Morris, Dave Cathias, and Double Dave action for you from the Oklahoma Restaurant Association Convention and Expo. Dave, there's a lot going on here.
That isn't. I'm so impressed at how you spat that out just now. I can't even remember the full title of this place. Congratulations on that. But yeah, this is an amazing event. This is where your food future is determined. All the restaurants are here, all the bars, and they're here to try out different things. There is more chicken nuggets here than there are chickens in the universe. I mean, it's crazy. Pizza, tacos, you name it, burgers. Wait till you see the fish. It's incredible. And it's all about excitement. And then, of course, here we got cocktails.
Well, so let's set this up. The convention and expo runs Wednesday and Thursday. It's not exactly open to the public. This is an industry situation. As Dave mentioned, the bar area behind us is the cocktail shakedown, and we've almost reached the finals of this situation. We just saw a little bit of the semifinals, some drinks lined up over here. As Tim Money will walk and talk over to the drinks, and they look pretty good, but I think they've been sitting there for demo purposes for a little bit.
You know, if I had to try one, I think I could probably make it happen. But yeah, those have been sitting there for a while. But even, you know what, even sitting there for a while, they still look really inviting. It just kind of shows off some of the talent that we have here in local bars.
We certainly do, and it's not just bartenders. Mixology has really taken off.
Oh, yeah.
And we've got a little bit of time to talk here, Dave. The bar scene has really gone from just mixed drinks and beer to now craft beer, but also the mixologists.
That's right. And, you know, you got guys now who are making their own bitters, and they're trying to emphasize local herbs to use in their cocktails. They take this sort of thing as just as seriously as a chef takes making a great entree.
And it's not just the taste or the flavor, it's the presentation. That's good looking drinks.
That's right. Yeah, there's a lot that goes into it. You want it to be appealing to the eye. You want it to be a balanced flavor, not overly sweet, not overly sour, right down the middle. You don't want to necessarily taste the alcohol. You want it to sort of blend in with whatever you've mixed in there. And so it takes a lot of time and a lot of practice.
The Cocktail Shakedown Finals will be starting here shortly behind us. They've reached the final two. I think they're deliberating among these semifinalists right now. They do have judges judging these drinks, and of course the contestants are up there on stage.
And I'm not one of them.
But you are here,
yes.
As the food dude should be, food editor of the Oklahoman, among the judges for the Culinary Cook-Off. Now that's a two-day competition. The Cocktail Shakedown basically started Wednesday morning, will end here shortly. But the Culinary Cook-Off ends tomorrow, and this is a big deal.
Yeah, it is. The chefs really take it seriously, the local chefs. If I took you through all 15 winners from over the years, you'd recognize practically all the names. All the really well-established chefs have come through. A lot of them have won it, and this year got a whole new crew of people. There's just a handful of veterans in there this year. Two-day event. It's a sort of a Iron Chef-style competition. Secret ingredients, and today, the heats today, they have 20 minutes to create their entrees, and we've been through two heats. We're actually in the middle of heat number three right now, and then tomorrow, about 1 o'clock, about the same time, we're going to have the final, and so it should be, and they'll have a full hour for that, so that's a lot of fun. They've been doing that one for, like I said, something like 15 years now. The cocktail competition, I believe, is only in its second year, so this one is still growing, still just a one-day competition, but I'm already starting to think they've got some things over here that we don't. So, you know, maybe I can spread myself a little thinner next year and do both. We'll see. I would enjoy that. I think you would do well over here.
I probably would. I'd enjoy both, that's for sure. Especially if there's more, what'd you say, more chicken nuggets than chickens? I'm still trying to do the math on that.
That's right.
That is a cool setup back there. They've got the mirrors so the people watching can actually see what's being prepared. They have the drop cameras. I mean, this is a pretty legit setup.
It really is. And this year they brought in some cameras that they've dropped down from the mirrors so that you've got a widescreen on the side that you can kind of check in on what they're doing. It's really, really cool. Right now they're cooking up frog's legs. Earlier we had quail for breakfast, had some skirt steak earlier today, and I believe some Peruvian potatoes are involved right now. But, you know, as you go around this event, you'll see that they don't seem as exotic because, you know, when you have a 65-pound Hawaiian moonfish on display, as they do over at the U.S. Foods booth, then some of that stuff starts to seem a little bit tame. But yeah, it's a lot of fun. And
you're making up food groups right now. A moonfish? What is a moonfish?
It's really big. It's hard to describe. You're going to have to go by and take a nice picture. It is huge. It's a big round fish. It looks like a giant guppy, I guess. And but that's what you see here. This is where the food providers, the brokers, the distributors, they want to bring the big stuff. you know, kind of the wow stuff to inspire restaurants to do new stuff.
Let's talk about that a little bit more. I was talking with Jim Hopper. He's with the Oklahoma Restaurant Association just a little bit ago. They're expecting 6,000 people here.
Yeah.
And I asked him, who are these people? I mean, it's not just chefs and restaurants. It is industry trade people. And this is an important event for them. Not every state in the nation has a big convention and expo like this, but Oklahoma is one of them, and clearly it's doing quite well.
Yeah, it really is. And like when you get around and you see all the different products, it kind of blows you away. But, you know, you've got Made in Oklahoma here with all the different people that they support. So they're doing their thing. Cusack Meats, who's been in business since the 30s, they're here. But then you have folks that are brand new, that are just now getting to this thing. So it's, you know, for someone like me, it's really great to catch up with people I know. But more importantly, to get to know some people who I've never met and kind of get to see what they're all about. Lots of samples. This is a good reason to get in the restaurant business, just so you can come to this event.
Our Grayson Cook, by the way, already took advantage of those samples. I believe we saw him perhaps putting the press pass to use this morning for some breakfast.
Yeah, that's true.
One cool thing, we'll be catching up with Rodney Bivens tomorrow. He's executive director of the Regional Food Bank, and this is another cool angle to this event. A lot of the food prep, a lot of the some of the displays and the things that are being produced at the various booths, each vendor has the option of donating that to the regional food bank. And tomorrow they will back their truck up and make a great haul. So it's a good cause as well.
Yeah, that's great. It's, you know, there's been a lot in the news about food waste lately. And I know that restaurateurs and the people in the food industry are aware of it. And honestly, they need education on it. And so sometimes you got to be proactive and say, hey, let's just do this. And if it's wrong, somebody will tell us. And so, I mean, because you're just trying to help people out. That's what we're doing here, you know, at this event. That's what these folks, they just want to help. They don't want to waste anything. And so it's tremendous. And I know Rodney, he's been involved with the ORA for a long time. They've got a great relationship. And, you know, the ORA, they have a foundation. They support part of what's going on over, we can talk about this real quick, over at the Oswald. Each chef that's competing is matched with a student, with a ProStart student. So not only does the chef stand to win some pretty nice cash and prizes, the student that works with him also gets a prize. And as Zena Dater was telling us earlier, about 90% of the kids who come up here, and they're not all kids, some of them are adults, the students that work with these chefs, they end up getting a job. So it's like a little informal a job interview.
Well, sure, a chef is working with a sous chef or students like I like the way he helped me saute those frog legs, if you will.
That's right.
Perhaps I want to work with him a little bit a little bit more. And there are some good culinary schools in the area, and I'm
Absolutely.
Sure that's where some of them are coming from.
Yeah, this or Platt College, I believe, is who's involved with this part of it. But yeah, we have several really good institutions if you're looking to learn how to cook. Obviously, Francis Tuttle does a great job. Kurt Fleischfresser has his apprenticeship program, much smaller, but, you know, really producing some great young chefs. But, yeah, it's Platt here. I think they're the biggest of the schools. It's an actual full college. But, yeah, and so there's a bunch of them over there in the crowd cheering on their fellow competitors.
I mentioned Dave Cathy is among the judges. Of course, his columns come out every Wednesday in the food section of the Oklahoman. He will have extensive coverage of this event in next week's editions and, of course, sure. updates online at newsok.com. You can follow him on Twitter. He's the food dude.
That's right.
As a judge, what are you looking for?
You know, they have really specific things that they want us to look for. There's some sort of random things, like how well do they use the student? How sanitary is their cooking station? You know, some little detail type stuff. But as the judges, I know technique is one of the things that they're mostly chefs. And so they want to see those chef techniques, those classic French technical flourishes on the plate. Because, you know, when everybody has the same ingredient and you only have 20 minutes, there's only so far that you can push it. So the dishes can tend to look a lot the same. And so when you can bring in those little flourishes, that's the sort of thing that is the cherry on top. Now, before you ever get to that, and we've seen this a little bit already, is you have certain ingredients that you're required to use in each dish. So it's very important that you really take care of those dishes, of those ingredients, the proteins. We quail was one, and they got little tiny bones in there. So you have to, you can't just take it for granted that, oh yeah, that'll turn out fine.
Did you have some quail bones in your omelet this morning?
Well, they were mostly served whole, so we had to kind of dig through them. But we did have one that was pretty rare, you know, rarer than you'd want. And another, we had a skirt steak, which is typically very tough, and you got to cut it just right. And there were some errors there, you know, and just little things like that. The dishes weren't bad, but when you're judging two or three things against each other, you got to start looking for the little blemishes, I guess. And I'm sure that's what they're doing here too.
How are your knife skills?
You know, they could be better. They're not bad. They're better than they used to be. But my son, who's in culinary school, his are already way better than mine. So, yeah. Yeah, so, no, you know, that's part of the fun for me is watching these guys do their thing in this very short amount of time and thinking there's no way I could ever do that. So, and we'll have a really nice production on that, so we can kind of show people what goes on at this competition.
The finals of the Culinary Cook-Off, I believe, will be at 1 o'clock tomorrow, Thursday. They will drop the curtain, if you will, to display not the mystery meat, but the mystery ingredient that everybody has to cook with tomorrow. We'll have live coverage of that on News OK as well. Dave, what's it look like back here? It looks like an empty stage.
Yeah. I saw one of the judges walk by eating something, so he must be running behind.
I see a DJ mixing. I do not see any mixologists on stage, although they may be getting ready to start here in just a second. I see Jeff walking by us right now. That's one of our judges. Some fine work he does over at the O-Bar at the Ambassador.
Dave was last year's winner.
Was he really?
That's right. Yeah, Jeff at the O-Bar, he won last year's competition. You can go on his Facebook page and see a really humorous picture of him and his adorning his belt. You know? But yeah, and Jeff does a great job. He knows all about it. He knows all there is to know about wine, and he's a really solid bartender, mixologist, whatever. Some of them get a little testy if you call them mixologists, because within the brotherhood, the term sort of is like, oh, so you're a mixologist, huh? You know. So there's a fine line there. So don't call your bartender a mixologist unless you know for sure it's okay.
Just make sure you know their name and tip them well, right?
That's right. Know his first name or his or her first name first.
One last thing for you, Dave, and we'll see how things proceed here. What are some of the things you're looking for on the convention floor? Because I'm looking back here, and there are a ton of booths. I mentioned there were 6,000 people expected. There's a lot of booths. There's a lot of events here.
Yeah, you know, for me personally, one of the things that I always gravitate towards, they have some really great produce here, produce that you don't even see in the grocery store. And so I love to go sample and see what's there and then keep my eye out for when it appears out in the restaurants.
Yeah, tell me more about that. You touched on this, and when you were telling me about this event before this week even came up, I thought that was a really cool angle to this story. This foreshadows what I might see in a restaurant or in the community being served up in the future. What do you mean by that?
Well, I'll give you an example. A couple of years ago, one of the vendors had what they call sea beans, which basically look like the stems on a juniper tree. But when you eat it, they come out of the ocean, and when you eat it, they're just very simple and have a little bit of a texture to it, and they're super salty. Well, the Drake opened, I guess it was last week, a dish comes out, it has sea beans in it. So it's like, aha, I know where these came from. You know, so it really does. This sort of foreshadows the kind of trends that you might see in restaurants. You know, I remember in the 90s when Chipotle got really popular, Chipotle peppers. I guarantee you it first was at a deal like this. And so, you know, I haven't had a chance yet to go around and see all the new stuff. Just I've only seen about half of what there is to see so far. But yeah, already the fish is already, I mentioned it a couple times already, but there's a lot more fish presence out here today. You know, actually a lot more spirits than I've seen in the past. So again, it's just going to be the little telltale signs of what you might see in the restaurants in the future, not grocery stores. This is all strictly, you know, your food service professionals. It could be a food truck, could be a food stand. It actually could be a restaurant inside of a grocery store. But yeah, this is all your, and even the other thing about it is it's all kinds of restaurants, not just fine dining. In fact, they really probably cater more towards the smaller diners. Some of these prepared foods that you're going to see, these are the chicken nuggets or the chicken strips or the bar food that you're going to see in your local bar. They're being presented today. So the pressure is on your local barkeep. Just make sure they pick the right thing to serve you.
Pretty cool. We're looking at some Lamb Western stuff right here.
That's right.
dip in dusted broccoli, if you will. It doesn't sound terrible.
It doesn't. And I have yet to find anything here that's just awful. But yeah, anything you can deep fry, it's almost like they're in cahoots with the fair. I mean, it really is. I've said this to people, like, if you like the fair, you would love this show, because it's all that kind of finger food. But, and then there's also great stuff too, like really high end stuff.
Lettuce chips, that sounds pretty good. I would have never thought you could actually fry lettuce, but I guess you can fry just about anything.
That's true. I mean, well, that's the one thing. I think the fair probably is the vanguard on what you can and can't fry. So I imagine maybe these folks, when they're done here, they'll go out to the fair and they'll come back and say, okay, next year, fried root beer.
You mentioned the Drake. I haven't been there yet. It's made quite the splash in the local culinary scene. Been open for a couple weeks. That's a Keith and Heather Paul Good Egg creation. How is it?
Oh, man. Yeah, I just posted a blog on it yesterday. Usually I wait until I've sat with them for a long time and gone through most of the menu. But my two visits so far have been so tremendous that I couldn't wait. I just had to let people know something this new, this exciting, seafood done in a way that has not ever been done in Oklahoma City. We actually have been doing seafood in Oklahoma City since 1902, but nothing like this. I was talking to Chris McCabe earlier today. They already got some new oysters in. They already had, I think, 7 varieties. They just added one more today. And that's what's going to be kind of fun about it, is it's going to rotate. When these different sorts of oysters come in and out of fashion, or in and out of season, I should say, then they'll replace them. But that's what they're all about. There's this sustainable program that they're trying to follow, so that they're serving not only the freshest fish, but the fish that is appropriate for the time of year. And, you know, it's very expensive to do it that way. And the fact that they've presented us with a restaurant where the price points are not crazy, they're actually very fair, very affordable. It's commendable of them to do that.
Talking about the Drake restaurant, it just opened weeks ago, 23rd and Western, in the trendy uptown district. A very nice looking place. It's not just oysters. I believe they have other seafood.
Oh, absolutely. Yeah. Hiramasa, which is a yellowtail that you usually would do for sushi. They do two different presentations. One that's a classic seared version. Fantastic. Lobster, shrimp, you name it. I mean, but oysters are kind of the thing. And then they'll start rotating the fish. Right now, like I said, Hiramasa's at the top of it. I can't think of any others off the top of my head. Oh, shrimp, of course. But there's also, you know, steak, and there's a fried chicken sandwich and lemon cloud pie. Remember that name. It is as good a lemon dessert as I've ever had.
Lemon cloud pie?
Yeah, lemon cloud pie. Limoncello liqueur is in the pie filling. It is tremendous.
Doesn't sound terrible at all. Dave Morris alongside Dave Cathy at the Oklahoma Restaurant Association Convention and Expo 2015. We're at the Cox Convention Center, day one of the 2-day event, and I believe you may be getting beckoned back over there.
I've got to get folks. I've got to go pay some food.
He's the food dude. Right. He's judging the culinary cook-off. Ends tomorrow. Go do some chefing, or actually, go do some judging of some chefing.
I will. You guys enjoy the cocktails.